Bebop is a beautiful but difficult language to learn. And if you're studying a musical language, then probably you first want to really listen to the phrases and then try and play them and get them into your system. And through that, you can also get them out into your own playing, into your own vocabulary. This lesson started with me making some examples for a lesson on how to use arpeggios in a bebop style. But then I ended up liking the examples so much that I just wrote a bunch more of them. And now it's more of a general lesson on bebop vocabulary and some solid examples of things you want to know if you want to play bebop. The way you should work with this is, of course, you should check out the phrases, you should listen to how I'm playing them, but you should also try to play them yourself and then take out small bits and pieces and try to make your own lines with that to get it into your own vocabulary. My name is Jens Larsen. Learn jazz, make music. Bebop lines are often reduced to just being arpeggios and scale runs, and if you're working on stuff like bebop scales, then you're kind of also working towards playing like that. But that's not really what a great bebop line is. I think you can see in this example there's a lot more going on. So I might have sort of scale movement between beat 1, which is the F, and beat 3, which is the E. But in between I have this, which is almost like a second voice that's in there. And I'm immediately changing it up by going to an enclosure on the third beat. And the G7 line is also really just chord tones in the beginning, so with a leading note, so. And then skipping around, accentuating the alterations with a trill. And then ending the line on C major. This lick has a great example of a way to sort of really pull the line forward, because very often what you can do is that you can insert an arpeggio that's played as an eighth note triplet, and because the notes are faster, then the final note really seems like a target note that you want to emphasize. But in this example, I have the ascending arpeggio up to the A flat, so. And actually it becomes a part of a chromatic enclosure right away, so we have this pull forward, and when we expect it to resolve on the beat here, it keeps on going into another chromatic movement and then resolves to the C major. Minor bar in this lick is another great example of how you can change the flow by just inserting things into stepwise melodies. So the first part of this is really just stepwise from G down to E. But here I'm inserting an entire A minor triad descending as a triplet, so. And then I'm continuing the stepwise motion from E to D and then running up the scale again. Then the G7 line, here I'm using something that's very common for bebop, is also the B augmented triad on a G7, so. Using the augmented sound here, adding a trill. And on the C major 7, so instead of just ending on the heavy beats, because that's not really something that you do a lot with bebop melodies, I'm extending the line and I'm ending in the middle of the bar, and I'm doing that by adding a short phrase on the C major 7, which is this short chromatic phrase. This lick really illustrates well how you can use arpeggios and arpeggio patterns to change the flow of the line and add some larger intervals and change the direction. It makes it a lot less predictable and boring to listen to, something I think is really important in a good solid bebop line. The first part of the line is just a scale run, and then we get, on B3, we get this F major triad, and here I'm skipping up from F to C, so really adding that fifth interval, and then changing the direction by just descending the arpeggio again. And I'm skipping around when I get to the G7 as well. Here I'm using a B diminished arpeggio, but I'm starting on the high B and then skipping down to play the rest. This is what's called octave displacement. And then adding a trill. And on the C major 7, I'm again also just keeping things moving by not just resolving on the one, but I have this fairly energetic melody with a lot of trills in it, ending on the 6 of C, which is an A. Number of great bebop lines are built around some voice leading ideas, and this is a very common example of that. So here I'm, instead of playing the 2-5-1 in C, I'm actually playing this D minor line cliche idea and then using that to play the 2-5. So I'm starting just with a D minor triad, then I want to emphasize the C sharp, so the D minor major, and I'm doing that by just playing a descending D minor major arpeggio. Notice that the range of this is pretty big. That's also something that makes it work a lot better and makes it a little bit more interesting and dramatic. And then I'm playing the last part, which is like D minor 7 to G7, like this, where the D minor 6 becomes a G7. And then I'm rounding that off with just a G7 to C major line. Of course, you can also use triplets for just scale movement, and that's what I'm doing here. So first we get a chromatic enclosure on the D minor, and then a scale one as triplets, and then an A minor triad. On the G7, I'm again using the augmented, so the B augmented, with this sort of octave displacement pattern. And then I have this motif of chromaticism where I'm using first this melody, and then mirroring that or developing that on the C major 7 with to end on the major 7 of the C. Opening to this lick is another example of how you can create still bebop sounding lines that have really a large range. So the first part is just an F major triad and then a descending F major 7 arpeggio. So we really have from this low F to this C covered in just that one bar. On the G7 I'm using a motif that I'm moving up in a minor third. So first we get this phrase and that's repeated a minor third higher. And this could be out of the altered scale, it could be out of the diminished scale as well. And then resolving on the C major 7 with this short tack. This example is all about having lines that really pull forward. So the first part is a chromatic enclosure, which is of course really pulling forward because it contains all these notes that don't really fit with a chord. Once it resolves on the D on B3, I'm skipping down, so creating some melodic tension by this large skip down to F, and then moving up the arpeggio. So really this is a D minor 7 arpeggio, and the stepwise movement here is resolving that, then going to B and doing the same idea, so skipping down to the D and then up the arpeggio, and then from there adding some alterations, and then finally resolving with this nice open fifth interval on the C major 7. using arpeggios with extensions is not that common in bebop. You'll find that a lot more used with people like Wes Montgomery, which is a little bit later. But here I'm actually using a D minor 9 arpeggio. So it's really just played as the first two notes are 8 notes and then a triplet. So, and then from here we get a chromatic enclosure to take us to the third of G7. And then again another example of an octave displaced dim arpeggio. And the C major 7 line in this case is a pattern of an E minor, so the arpeggio from the third really ending on that open major 7 sound like this. In the D minor bar, in this example, I have another way of just changing around sort of a scale movement, and in that way creating a much more interesting and surprising line. So the first part is just really a basic enclosure and an arpeggio, chromaticism, and then I'm skipping up to a G to hit the F on the G7 here. And it could of course have worked just as well to just do this in sort of a stepwise manner, so like this, but that's a lot less interesting and a lot less dramatic than. So really what I'm doing is that I'm just approaching from the other side and choosing to sort of come at it in a more surprising way. Then we get another example of where I'm just adding chord tones as sort of a second voice under this note, so. And then a trill from the sharp 9, a leading note, and then resolving. Actually kind of resolving on the two end, so this part becomes a part of the G7 line. And this way of playing across the bar line is also something that you will find quite often in bebop, especially Parker does this really often. A big part of the sound of bebop is of course adding all these chromatic phrases and this chromaticism to your solos. And if you want to check out some more options for this, then check out this video where I'm going over 10 different examples of how to use different types of chromatic leading notes, chromatic enclosures, and chromatic phrases in your playing. Thank you for watching. See you next week.